And turn with me, please, to the book of 1 John. I'll be reading 1 John chapter 1 today for our scripture reading. I'll be focusing on the first three verses, but I want to read the entire chapter for us. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon and touched with our hands, concerning the word of life. The life was made manifest, and we have seen it, and testify to it, and proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father, and was manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us, and indeed our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And we are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is a message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus his Son cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And if we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Where was Thomas on the night Jesus rose from the grave? We don't know the answer to that question, but we know where he was not. He wasn't with the other disciples when Jesus miraculously appeared among their midst. You could speculate that he was out for a walk, scratching his head, trying to figure out what happened the last 3 days. He had committed his life to following this Jesus of Nazareth, and he had been crucified on the cross. And his dreams were shattered. When he returned to the disciples were all abuzz. They were talking about the resurrected Lord appearing before them, and they had seen him. And they were excited. But Thomas said to them, unless I see with my own eyes, and unless I touch the wounds, unless I put my hand in his side, I will not believe. He thought his friends were delusional. Eight days later, Thomas was with his friends, and Jesus appeared again. And he looked at Thomas and said, behold my hands. Look at my hands. Touch, if you will. And how did Thomas respond? He responded in humble praise, adoration, my Lord and my God. And then Jesus said to Thomas, have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen me and yet believed. Blessed are those who have not seen me and yet believe. When we come to our text for today, John is writing to those who hadn't seen the Savior as he had seen the Savior. They hadn't walked with him and talked with him and been on the Mount of Transfiguration with him. They hadn't been with him in his physical ministry. But John wants us to make sure that we realize that he and the apostles had seen the Christ. Verse 1, that which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon and our hands have touched. Verse 2, the life was manifest to us and we have seen it. Verse 3, that which we have seen and heard, we proclaim unto you. The Church of Jesus Christ is based on the foundation laid by the apostles and the prophets. The New Testament was written by men who had either been with Jesus or had been in close and intimate fellowship with those who had been with Jesus. And John here references what Westcott points out is the fullness of the apostolic experience. These men had seen the Christ. They had been with him. They had watched his miracles. They had observed the power of his teaching, the authority of his teaching. They had seen his compassion. They had seen his boldness. They had seen that which was lived out in Jesus' life, that life of perfect obedience. They had observed that for themselves. John and the other apostles were eyewitnesses of the power and the majesty and the glory of our great Savior. As you spend the year studying at RPTS, please understand that what we teach you is based on historic fact, that which really happened in time and history. It's unlike any other religion in that regard. We aren't a religion per se. We are a religion, but we have truth, historic fact, upon which we base our claims. You may be surprised to know that we are in the minority of seminaries today in North America that still hold to the historic facts of the gospel. Most of them were started with that understanding. But RPTS is among the minority of schools, seminaries in this country that still proclaim a gospel based on the historic facts. I remember a time when I was in another city, and I was talking to one of the students about their campus. And I said to this woman, do most of your students here believe in the substitutionary atonement of Jesus? And she pondered it just for a second and said, not the substitutionary atonement part. What do you have left if not the substitutionary atonement of Christ? A professor in another seminary in town just got released this summer for believing the historic facts of the gospel. don't take it for granted that what you're getting here is what you would get in other seminaries in North America. There is clearly an existential or an experiential or experimental aspect to our religion, to our faith. And we're going to talk about that in a moment. But please understand, our faith is rooted in historic fact. None of us in this room have seen or heard or followed Jesus of Nazareth like the apostles had. But Peter says we have a prophetic word made more certain. Peter, one of the 12, he'd been with John on the Mount of Transfiguration. He had observed, he had been there when the Father said to the Son, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." He had observed the majesty and the radiance of that moment. But Peter says, we have the prophetic word confirmed. What we have in this book is more real than what the apostles saw with their own eyes. Now, they saw it. It's not more real. That's a bad term. But it's confirmed to us now because of the witness of the apostles. And John and Peter weren't the only ones who would make this claim. Remember Paul writing to the Corinthian church, 1 Corinthians 15. And what did he say was of first importance? The crucifixion, the burial, and the resurrection of our Lord. And he said, he appeared to the apostles, appeared to me. And then he said he appeared to 500 people at one time, most of whom are alive today. That is, you don't have to believe me. Go talk to the 500 people that are still alive that observed the resurrected Christ. Our gospel message is rooted in what happened in time and history, and you have to understand that if you're going to understand the gospel. If we are wrong on the facts of the gospel, we are of all people most to be pitied. But notice for our text today, from our text today, verse 3. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, so that you may have fellowship with us, and indeed our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. John, writing under divine inspiration, says, it's not merely about the facts of the gospel. We have fellowship with one another, and we have fellowship with the triune God, Father, and with His Son. And as I said to you yesterday, those of you who were there, here, if you just want head knowledge, you probably are in the wrong seminary, because we're concerned about the heart of the matter. We're concerned about your relationship with the living God. If you don't cultivate that relationship, you are not getting what we want for you to get here at RPTS. It's more than facts. It's more than theology. It's a fellowship with one another and with the living Christ. In Acts 2:42, we read that those who believed and were baptized, and there were thousands of those who believed and were baptized, and what did they devote themselves to? They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Fellowship wasn't just something that happened automatically. Those who believed devoted themselves to the fellowship, to fellowshipping with one another. And John says, and truly our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, the Lord Jesus. The word is koinonia. Friendship, partnership, participation, sharing in the relationship we have with the triune God. We talk a lot at the seminary about union with Christ. And that is a blessed doctrine that really encapsulates who we are as Christians. But union with Christ goes with communion with Christ. We are united to Christ. We are in Him so that we may commune with Him, so that we may fellowship with Him, so that we may fellowship with believers of all. At one level, we fellowship with believers of all time, the universal church, but in a specific way, we fellowship with one another here. You fellowship with one another in your local churches. But I draw your attention today. Our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, the Lord Jesus. We want you to work this year at cultivating relationship, cultivating fellowship, cultivating friendship with the risen Christ. He is not just our Savior. He is not just our elder brother. We are adopted into the family of God, and we fellowship with Him, and we seek to worship Him in all that we do. Some seminaries today are called cemeteries. And that's kind of the buzz out there in the world. Oh, you go to seminary. You go to cemetery. Oh, I mean seminary. That's not the way it is here. If you don't cultivate and have more faith and have a closer prayer life as a result of being at RPTS, we have failed you. So at RPTS, we want you to cultivate the faithfulness and the fellowship that comes through close relationship with our Savior. Let me read again the first three verses. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have and have touched with our hands concerning the word of life. The life was made manifest, and we have seen it, and testify to it, and proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and was manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, that you may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the fact that in time and history, our Lord Jesus Christ forfeited the glories of heaven, humbled himself and became a man, lived a life of perfect obedience, was crucified, buried, resurrected. He now has ascended into heaven and he sits at your right hand. And Lord, we pray that as we study here at RPTS this year, that you would confirm our own faith in you, that you would confirm our fellowship with you and increase our fellowship with you and with one another. Hear our prayers. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.